They are great leaders because they are shock absorbers. Do you know what a shock absorber is? Anyone who drives a vehicle, you understand that when you go over rough terrain and rough territory, that you don't feel the bumps and the rough terrain because you have shocks. And sometimes we overlook the shocks because we want to pay more attention to how the vehicle looks. We're more concerned. You have never gone to the car wash and washed your shocks. But you go there and you take care of the exterior, not
That's
understanding
good.
That that car would fall to pieces based upon the rough terrain if there were not a good pair of shock absorbers that were in position.
Thank you, God.
That's what your pastors are. That when there is something that was meant for you, they take place as the shock absorbers. So you don't feel the rough terrain.
Help us, God.
Are you hearing what I'm saying, people of God? You don't absorb, the rough terrains because they are positioned as great leadership over the flock, and they take on all of the bumps, the attacks, the spiritual warfare. And we're starting to wonder why our house is so blessed. It is because someone stood in the gap and took on the pain, that was meant for you. And now we then wonder why there are some days when the leadership comes and they're drained. And I know what I'm saying, people of God. And that's when we, as the people, must stand up and say, our leaders can sit today because we have been trained enough to carry the mantle and handle the service. Come on, people of God. Are you working with me? That we can preach. We don't need a certificate. We don't need seminary. We just know the word.
We know what to say. We know what to do. Come on.
Over the people and speak. Because our
That's
pastors
good.
Have taken on so much of shock that was meant for my house. That I just want to give God praise and let them sit. My God. Are you hearing, people of God? Okay, let's get into this. Amen. I feel light in my feet. I do. Man. Pastor Jimmy, you don't know how much you blessed me when I saw what you had on. I was like, I ain't dressed church clothes. I ain't packing. I didn't pack them. So we gonna see how this goes. And when I saw him, I thought the glory is here. Glory is here. Amen. All right. Just pray for me. Amen. That's all I ask. Pray for me. We're going to talk about the glory of God. What the Lord has given me is that there are three capacities of glory that we want to discuss today. Amen. Three capacities of glory. Amen. The first one is... it is the heavy-weighted presence of God. That is the first capacity of glory. That it is the heavy-weighted presence of God. Amen. I'm going to say that again. It's the heavy-weighted presence of God. So oftentimes when you are under pressure, stop calling the enemy. When it could be the heavy-weighted presence of God. Not
That's
to
good.
Hinder you, but to provoke you to do better.
Yes. That's good. That's good.
Y'all gonna let me shout by myself? Go. I'm telling you, this is easy now. Pastor Mitchell, kick the door out. This is easy for me. You know what I mean? Kicking the door, waving the... Okay, let's see. It is the heavyweight presence of God. So there are things that has to happen to us to cause revelation. What God did was he created a situation in order to get revelation. And his expression to the world is who we are. To get his point across to the world, he created us. You don't think that God could have done this himself? He said, I'm going to get my point across and cause revelation in the earth. So I'm going to instill my spirit, oh God, in man so that they can then go forth and create glory. And when we do that, it's going to be some painful experiences that we have to endure in order to express the glory of God to the earth. Amen. Look at somebody and say, it wasn't all that bad. Amen. Your perspective of it was bad. You saw it as bad.
But Jesus, come on, prophet.
Says,
come on.
What the devil meant for evil, God turned it for the good so that it may save many people. Maybe you went many through that so alive. Somebody can get saved. He didn't just turn it around for your good so you can be blessed, but he turned it around so somebody can join the kingdom. Amen. I hear what I'm saying, people of God. That's why we're experiencing so much hurt and so much tragedy and pain, because somebody's watching you. Amen. Look at somebody and say, somebody's watching you. And they want to see how you respond to this crisis.
It's the
they
truth,
want to see how you respond to
somebody's watching.
Then you keep saying, God is great. And now that the situation appears to have turned in your life, the microscope is on you to see how you respond to this situation. And God is just looking for some radical people that will say, I will stand for what God says I should stand for, and I will die for what, oh my God, I hope you hear what I'm saying. I'm at a point in my life that I will die for whatever God says I have to stand for. Are you hearing what I'm saying, people of God?
You're talking good.
Amen. Because we have experienced so much. We have gone through so much, and it was all for the glory of God. My perspective has shifted. I'm not looking at everything as just negative, but I'm looking at it and saying, how can God get the glory? Oh my God, I'm hoping to speak. How can he get the glory out of this? Are you hearing me, people of God? Now, when we look at Jesus, amen. These are just conferences. We're just supposed to discuss some stuff. We ain't supposed to be preaching, do we? But when we look at Jesus, now, Jesus is at the point of his life, and he's talking to us, and he comes to God not with affirmation, but he comes to God with a question. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Now, he's at a point where he's about to cross over into destiny, and he has a question. This is Jesus we're talking about. Okay, now, he didn't affirm. He didn't come to the place of death where he said, this, but he's saying, God, I have a question. Is there anybody else in here that has questions to God? Oh my God, if that's you, you're in good company, because whenever you have a question for God, that means that destiny is a few steps away. You have gotten to the point where there's so much pressure that now you say, God, my God, why has God forsaken me? What is it, God, that you're trying to get out of me? All right, you hear what I'm saying? My God, because see, I got questions.
That's good.
And I'm like, Lord, but why, Lord? Why would you want to use? Now, she talked about how this is transparency, right? So we can be transparent up in here. Yeah. Amen. Praise God. I was going to do it anyway, but I'm glad you're agreeing with me. But we talk about transparency. And I said, Lord, why would you want to use me? for your ministry? Why, Lord? Why are you selecting me? Lord, don't you know my record? Don't you know my past? Now, watch this, people of God. This is after I got saved. Okay, everybody got a testimony before you got saved. But God is looking for some real people that have messed up after. Okay. After the initial sermon. After the appointment to the Lord. God is looking for some real people after they called you intercessor. After they called you prophet. Can you still stand up then? Lord, I got some questions, Lord. Why, Lord? Why have you forsaken me for this? Why do I have to deal with this, Lord? Well, why, Lord? Why when I turn around and I got brothers and sisters in my house that won't talk to me? Lord, why is this happening to me? Lord, why did I have to take for my sister to die for people to then rise up in my household and my family to now start to have discussion? Lord, why, Lord? Why have you forsaken me for this? Why was it at the family reunion? Why couldn't we all just get along then? Why somebody had to die for us to then appreciate one another? And God said, it's because when somebody dies, I will produce. Okay. Yeah. There is always production when you allow something to die. Look at somebody and say, you better let that thing die in your life. Stop giving CPR to your past and let it die. Look at somebody and say, let it die. Yeah, let it die. Stop allowing yourself to be getting to places where you are giving your emotions to other people, where other people have control over your mindset. You are more concerned about what they say than what the Spirit of the Lord has said. It's the heavyweight presence of God. Amen. That's where we are. That's the capacity. Amen. That is the heavy weighted presence of God. That God turned around and created a situation for revelation. Oh my God. That's what he did. He created it. Amen. You wonder why you're having so many financial issues. It's because I had to create that so you can know what Jehovah Jireh means. If I have never, oh my God, if I would have just allowed everybody to be rich, then you will miss out on a big portion of who I am. Because you have been relying on the government, relying on your job, relying on your own skill set and mindset. And God says, I am Jehovah Jireh. I will cut some stuff off only so that you can come to me. Oh my God. Are you hearing what I'm saying, people of God? And then you turn around and got energy, identity issues where you're not recognizing who you are. And he said, I am Jehovah Nisi. I am the banner of God. Amen. And I can see my name up on the banner. And every time you have an identity crisis of who you are, God says, just remember who I am. That I created you. Oh, my God. Look at somebody and say, I know who I am. Amen. I know who I am. Amen. All right, so now let's look at this. The Holy Spirit is here. Amen. The anointing of God is here.
It's here.
And what I appreciate about this house and what I appreciate about this city, amen, is that this is a city, amen. I'm talking to us in here. This is a city that God does not have to visit. This is where he lives. Okay, somebody that ain't catching up right there. Amen.
Amen.
Now, what that means is that we don't have to try to conjure up the Spirit of God here. What it means is that everywhere we walk, the Spirit of God is evident. And if you don't believe that, just look into your spiritual mirror. Because you were created in his image. Oh my God. Look at somebody and say, I'm in his image. I was created in his image. And I want people to know that because I created them in his image, that everywhere you go, people should see the Spirit of God.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
They're not just looking at what you drive to see the Spirit. They're not just looking at where you live to see the Spirit. They're looking at how you deal with your situations in order to see the Spirit. Yeah, because if it was just about materialistic items, we would not have millionaires killing themselves. It is about how you live. Are you hearing me, people of God? So he created a situation for revelation. Amen. And that's why you were created. So the world can get revelation of who God is. Oh, everybody should have just ran and touched the ceiling on that. Because every time I thought I was less than, God says he created me so I can reveal the world to who he is. Yeah. Now, the Bible also says in Romans 12 that, I don't think more highly of myself than I ought, but I know who I am in God. Do you know who you are in God? If you knew who you were in God, then you would not have a depressive look on your face. Yeah. If you knew who you were in God, that when they talked about layoffs, you would lift your hands. Because your layoff can only create an opportunity for you to do something else. I will never lack again. Because as long as God is my source, prophesy to somebody and say, he's my source. He's my source. Amen. The people that came from my church, they understand this. That in the state of Connecticut, we have $1.3 billion deficit right now. And now they're talking about laying off and doing this and that and the third. And the company that I work for, we don't know what we're going to do. And I just be sitting back and saying, well, whatever you're going to do, just hurry up and do it. I ain't trying to expedite the process of God, but I'm just saying there's something greater that is waiting for me. Because the scripture is clear. The Apostle Paul said, there is a great and effective door that I have opened for you. And the only way you can walk through that door is I got to create something on this side to push you to the door. It wasn't to delay you. It was to push you to the door. Oh, you hear what I'm saying, people of God? The scripture also says that at the door, my adversaries would be many. So in other words, what that says is, anywhere you go to any type of building, you will always see an exit sign. At that exit sign, it's always lit up in red to let you know where to go in case of crisis. That's what your adversaries are. They are lit up at the door to let you know where to go. You didn't know where to go. You was confused. Look at the door with all the haters. That's the door you should go through. Oh my God. Are you hearing what I'm saying, people of God? Stop rebuking them and wasting oil on them and trying to change their minds and just hop skip through the door and say thank you for showing me where great and effective was. I would not have known until you showed me. Amen. Every time they come against you, you should shout. Because they're trying to show you where the great and effective door is. We spend too much time worrying about the adversary. We spend too much time talking about who's at the door. Who cares who's at the door? Just go through. Are there any people that just want to go through the door? And you're not concerned who's at the door? But you didn't play something. It's just like what it says in Psalms. That he created a table before us in the presence of our enemies. I don't care who's sitting here eating with me. I'm just grateful that I can still eat. Oh, somebody missed that right there. I'm just grateful that God trusts me. Because if it had not been for the Lord on my side, when my enemies got to the table, I might have pulled my razor out. Oh, I thought we was transparent. But God said, I trust you to sit around your haters. Do anything but give me praise. Oh, you're at a whole blessed another level when you can sit amongst your enemies and do nothing. Now that's called maturation process. Because a few days ago, okay, some of y'all say a few years ago, some of y'all say a few months ago. No, a few days ago, if I had sat at the table with some of my enemies, it might have been a crime scene. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay, let's get to the second point. Amen.